Welcome to the 42nd Theoretical Physics Colloquium by Professor Nora Brambilla, who is a group leader of Theoretical Particle and Nuclear Physics Group at Technical University of Munich in Germany. She received her PhD in 1993 from the University of Milan, and she got her habilitation in Theoretical Physics at the University of Vienna in 1999. After receiving PhD, she had several postdoctoral positions, including the ones at the University of Milan, Jefferson Lab, University of Heidelberg, University of Vienna. She at two of those last positions, she was actually Alexander von Humboldt Fellow and Marie Curie Fellow, respectively. She also then returned back to University of Heidelberg briefly before becoming a research scientist at Philips Labs in 2001, and then receiving an assistant professor position at the University of Milan in Italy in 2002. She spent there about 6 years before moving to the Technical University of Munich in Germany. She has done a lot of professional service for the community. As of 2017, she's a member of the Scientific Advisory Board of the Stefan Meyer Institute for Subatomic Physics in Vienna. She is also editor of Letters in High Energy Physics, which is a UK-based journal. She received numerous awards and honors over the years. As I already mentioned briefly, she was Alexander von Humboldt Fellow in 1997, Marie Curie Fellow 98-99. She was Humboldt Fellow, long-term collaborator in 2001-2002, and in 2012 she was elected Fellow of the American Physical Society. And the quotation says, for her contribution to the theory of heavy quark-antiquark systems, including the development of new effective field theories, for contributions to the field of heavy quark-quanium physics through the founding and leadership of the quark-quanium working group. Her research interests include theoretical particle and nuclear physics, effective quantum field theories for the standard model and beyond, hadronic physics of and quark-quania, field theories at finite temperature, Hadamard collisions, early universe, perturbative and non-perturbative methods in field theory, even lattice gauge theory. And today she will be talking about non-relativistic multiscale systems with effective quantum field theories. And with that, I'll give the microphone to Nora.
Thanks so much, Igor. Thanks so much for the invitation, for the nice presentation. It's a great pleasure for me to be here with you and to speak about non-relativistic multiscale system with effective quantum field theory. The content of my talk is the following. I will show you that non-relativistic bound and threshold states are multiscale systems. They have been at the root of quantum physics and they have triggered many revolutions. Today, they are very relevant in many processes as a frontier of particle and nuclear physics and also in other fields. In strongly interacting physics, in particular, this system allows simplification and are golden probe of the strong dynamics. I will show you that non-relativistic effective field theory allow to describe this system in quantum field theory. In particular, the potential non-relativistic effective field theory that I will present allows to address the bound state dynamics, to define the potential as matching coefficient, and to do systematic calculation both at the perturbative and the non-perturbative scale and in presence of additional scales, like for example, the temperature of the hot QCD medium. So then I will concentrate on the new frontier that are this non-relativistic system in complex or non-equilibrium environment. And I will speak about the theory to describe them. And in particular, I will concentrate on the exotic states, X, Y, Z, that have been discovered at the Higgs Energy Collider, quark-quanium production, and on the non-equilibrium revolution of non-relativistic system in the medium, for example, quark-quanium in the QGP or dark matter in the early universe. So the non-relativistic system that we all know is the hydrogen atom. The velocity in the bound state in such system is order of magnitude of the fine structure constant, and the system is endowed with free scale, the scale of the mass of the electron, which is much bigger than the momentum transfer, mv, which is much bigger than the binding energy. Since v is of order alpha, these scales are well separated. So hydrogen and other non-relativistic bound states have accompanied the history of quantum theory from its start up to the establishing of the quantum theory of fields. It was in 1926, it was formulated the Schrödinger equation to address the hydrogen properties. And then in order to explain the detail of the spectrum, one had to add relativistic correction, and they came from the Dirac equation. Relativistic correction is expansion in 1 over m, and they contain the spin correction, the spin orbit. This allowed to understand better the spectra, the hydrogen spectrum, but doing so, it didn't give the Lanz shift, which is a purely quantum field theoretical effect. In 1951, the Petersal-Peter equation was written down that should be the equation that is describing the bound states in relativistic quantum field theory. It is an integral equation that is writing the green function of two bodies in terms of itself convoluted with a kernel. The kernel is containing all the interaction. And this kernel only is a non-relativistic limit, leading order, reduced to the Coulomb potential in QED. But in general, it keeps entangled all bound state scales. And this is particularly problematic in the non-relativistic case because these non-relativistic systems are multi-scale systems, and inside this kernel, these scales get entangled. And since the bound state is always non-perturbative, so one has to resum with the kernel infinite series of diagrams, this complicates calculation tremendously. And in fact, this equation is cumbersome in perturbation theory. And the simplest example of that is the fact that going from the calculation of the correction to the hyperfine splitting of positronium ground state at order n alpha to the 5 to the next term, that is n alpha 6 log alpha, took 25 years from the paper of Karpus and Klein in 1952 to the paper of Caswell, Lepage and Baudouin-Yenny in the 1979-78. Moreover, the equation is very poorly suited to achieve factorization, which is especially important in QCD, where we want to factorize as much as possible the eigenergies that we control in perturbation theory to the low energy that is as a property of confinement. So the effective field theory approach, and in particular potential relativistic effective field theory. And the effective field theory approach means disentangling, separating the bound state scale at the Lagrangian level. And this has many advantages. The first advantage is this facilitates higher order perturbative calculation. And this is relevant for a number of states where these higher order perturbative and systematic calculation are needed, for example, in atomic physics, positronium, muonium, TT bar threshold production, dark matter annihilation and production, or states with two heavy quark or three heavy quark with a small radius. Then, in QCD and in strongly coupled theory, it factorizes high energy from low energy. The low energy scale can be dominated by non-perturbative effects, lambda QCD, or thermal effects, and it is very important to be able to separate them. And this, again, has an impact on a number of states that I listed here, and include quarkonium, exotics, and what I will describe is evolution in a medium. Then, doing so, we can integrate out hierarchically also other scales using other effective field theory. For example, we can address the temporal scale combining the non-relativistic effective field theory with our thermal loop. And then we can factorize the low energy thing, and we can apply lattice directly on the low energy factorized part instead of evaluating everything ab initio on the lattice. And finally, the effective field theory allow us to define in quantum field theory objects of great importance, like the potential. They get a proper definition in quantum field theory. Moreover, conceptually, The effective field theory description provides a field theoretical foundation of the Schrödinger equation. The Lagrangian that I will introduce, the Lagrangian of P and R effective field theory, is written in this way. There is a part that contains a two-particle field phi that contains the Schrödinger dynamics. And then there is another part that is delta lambda that is addressing the low energy dynamics. And this, if you start from any QFT, the for a non-relativistic bound state, potential non-relativistic effective field theory is the lowest energy effective field theory that can be constructed for the non-relativistic bound system. It implemented the Schrödinger equation at zero order problem, which is very good because this is the zero order problem that should be used in a non-relativistic bound system. It defines the potential as a level of the QFT, implements systematically retardation correction like the Lamb shift, encodes Poincaré invariance, and it is constructed to be equivalent at any given order of the expansion to the underlying quantum field theory. If the underlying quantum field theory is QED, you write down PNR QED, and this gives a proper version of quantum mechanics. So I will concentrate on a rich physical example of a non-relativistic system, quarkonium. We know that in 1974, the JPSI discovery triggered the so-called November Revolution, the discovery of the charm and the confirmation of asymptotic freedom. Today, as I will show to you, quarkonium is a golden probe of strong interaction. From the physical point of view, it's a pretty interesting system that adds another scale, which is lambda QCD, to the other scale of the bound state system, and requires two different versions of PNR effective field theory, weakly coupled and strongly coupled, as we will see. So, heavy quarks offer a privileged access. Quarkonium is a bound state made by two heavy quarks. The scale of the mass is bigger than lambda QCD. So, the simplification is that we can do perturbation theory at this scale. But this is like that also for the B and D meson for heavy light system. So, this system are characterized by just two scales, M, and the rest is all Brown Mach, all lambda QCD. Quarkonium is inherently different. It is a non-relativistic bound system, and it is, as such, a multiscale system. It is really the counterpart of the electromagnetic bound states. And I will show to you that the existence of many scales is an opportunity for the physics you can do, but it is a challenge for the theory that you have to develop. So if we look at the quarkonium spectrum, here I put bottomonium and charmonium, S-states and P-states, normalized with respect to the P-states to have everything on the same plot. Just look at that. We know the order of magnitude of the mass of the bottom and mass of the charm, they are large scale. And then we assume that the velocity square in bottomonium state is order 0.1 and in charmonium is 0.3. Then we see that the difference in energy level is scaling like mv to the square, while the difference in the hyperfine and fine separation is scaling like nv to the 4. This is the same scaling that you have in the hydrogen atom. So from the spectrum, you see that this is a non-relativistic system. And as such, it has at least three scales. The R scale, scale of the mass, the scale of the moment, which is bigger than the scale of the momentum transfer, called the soft scale, which is the reverse of the size R of the system, which is bigger than the scale of the binding energy, the ultra soft scale. If V is smaller than one, these scales are separated. And then there is always lambda QCD, which is the scale at which non-perturbative effects become dominant, and you can never switch off in QCD. So, since quarkonium is endowed with this scale, it is a particularly good probe of strongly interacting physics. So here I plotted the quark-antiquark potential as a function of the distance, and here there are some typical average radius of bottomonia and charmonia. And we see that there are charmonia and bottomonia with small radius that are probing the high energy region, and those that extend in the confinement region. So they are probing the two regions, high energy and low energy, dominated by confinement, and also the intermediate transition region. So they are very interesting probes. This at t equals zero, but you may imagine to look at this system, for example, a charm anti-charm, inside a medium, a hot QCD medium, that is characterized by a scale of in equilibrio, is characterized by a scale of temperature, and by mass, GT. Then it was the original idea of Matsui and Satz that the potential, so the interaction between this heavy quark would be screened by the presence of the medium, and in particular when the radius would be of the order of magnitude of the reverse of the debye screening, the bound state would dissolve. And so it was the idea that quarkonia of different radii can work like a thermometer of the quark gluon plasma. And in fact, we do heavy ion collision experiment. And one of the probes that we use to understand what is going on in heavy ion collision, and if we are really creating a hot QCD medium called quark gluon plasma, is to count how much the quarkonium is suppressed in heavy ion collision with respect to PP, this famous nuclear modification factor, RAA. And this is extremely important because with this kind of experiment, we want to test the QCD phase diagram that has a status as important as the state diagram, sorry, as the state diagram of water, which is fundamental. So we want to know how nuclear matter change when we change the pressure and the temperature. And we do these experiments in order to recreate the condition of the early universe, so with a lot of temperature, and to arrive at the confined transition in which quark and gluons are free. So we heat and compress nuclear matter at very high temperature and very high energy density. And then this collision are really going beyond our possibility. This is the multiplicity of the particles that are created in heavy ion collision. So they need clear probes, and non-relativistic heavy systems are good probes. Moreover, quarkonium can serve for precise extraction of standard model parameters, we will see, and in its exotic manifestation, like its X, Y, Z, is really probing the characteristic of non-abelian gauge theory, hybrids, multi-quark configuration. We have never seen them realized in nature. Moreover, quarkonium can also be used as an ideal probe of some phase space or beyond the standard model. Another reason for which quarkonium is very good to study strong interaction is that we have a lot of data. There were the B factories that were constructed to study CP, but they became mainly heavy meson factories. This with the Fermilab experiment, Rick, Hera, Cleo, and so on, provided a number of new states, new production mechanisms, exotics, new decays in transition, precision and high statistic data. And this wealth of data are still pouring from our experiment, BES-3 at YEP, the experiment CMF, ATLAS, LACB at the Large Hadron Collider, the ION experiment like ALIS and RIC, BEL-2 at SuperKP. And moreover, will come in future PANDA FAIR, the Electron-Hadron Collider, target experiment. All this has created a new revolution. So for the combined effort of all this experiment, this is what we know nowadays in the Charmonion sector. You see, all these states below the threshold, strong decay threshold, here the blue one were the ones that we knew 30, 20 years ago. The red one have been discovered in the last few years, and all this plethora of states that are at or above the strong decay threshold, sorry, the XYZ states, this have been discovered in the last few decades. And they are still to be understood, and they are really peculiar of the strong interaction. Same thing in the Bottomonion sector, where here there's a state below threshold. This blue one have been discovered in the latest years. And we have also particular states of exotic nature at and above the threshold. So, from the point of view of physics, quarkonium is a very stimulating system. But what about theory? Of course, to get advanced, we should have the experimental data and a theory that is able to do precise calculation rooted in field theory. However, this is a very challenging problem because it's a bound state problem in field theory. So when we are close to the bound state, even if we are fully perturbative, alpha s is going like V, threshold states. And then if we are considering the interaction between the quark and the antiquark that are exchanging a gluon, and we are considering this diagram with a potential gluon, we see that this diagram is not suppressed with respect to the first one. If we would be on shell, it would be. But here, the correction is counting one. So you have to sum the all infinite ladder of gluons to get the propagator with a Coulomb potential. To say the same thing from another perspective, you have to solve the zero order problem, which is a Schrödinger equation, and this generates scale. The scale is a momentum transfer, and the scale is a binding energy that are both proportional to V. Then, if you want to do a proper calculation in field theory, you will have to deal with diagram like this, in which you have a quark, an anti-quark. You have R gluons that can give origin to annihilation, production. You have gluons that give the binding, these soft gluons. And you have very low energy gluons, these gluons that give effects like retardation, lamp shift. So it's very difficult to calculate this in theory, even if you are in QED. You may imagine in QCD because this scale gets entangled. Moreover, even if you are a lattice person and you want to do a lattice ab initio calculation, it is difficult to set on a lattice with a finite lattice space and lattice size all the scale of the system. So the solution would be to formulate a hierarchy of effective field theory in correspondence of the hierarchy of scales. And let me recall what is an effective field theory. We can describe an effective field theory for the system with two energy scales. We have a large energy scale, capital lambda, to which it corresponds a small distance scale, and a small energy scale, small lambda, to which it corresponds a large distance scales. When we are looking at the system from farther away, we may imagine that we cannot resolve the details at high energy. An effective field theory is making the expansion in the ratio of these two scales explicit at the Lagrangian level. And the effective field theory Lagrangian, suitable to describe this system with these two scales, the system H with these two scales, is defined by a cutoff and by some degrees of freedom that are dynamical, they exist only at scales lower than the cutoff. The effective field theory Lagrangian is made by all the operators that may be built from the effective degrees of freedom and are consistent with the symmetry of your system. So it comes out in this factorized form. It is factorized in the product of some Wilson of matching coefficients that depend on the large scale, some low energy operators that depend on the small scale, and they are dynamical, they contain the dynamical degrees of freedom, and it is expanded in the large scale. So this has a lot of points. Since the operator is scaling like the small scale to its dimension, the effective field theory is actually organized in expansion in a small parameter. So you have a power counting. When we prediction for the spectra, the transition, the decay, we can attach an error to it that is coming from the power counting. The effective field theory is renormalizable order by order in this expansion, and this is a model view on renormalization. We know that the standard model is renormalizable only by accident. Then this matching coefficient encodes the non-analytic behavior in this case that is integrated out. They are calculated by imposing a matching procedure between the green function in the original theory and in the effective field theory. So we have a well-defined procedure that is a matching, that defines a matching coefficient.
Nora? Then,
yes.
There is a quick question from Stephen Watson asking, do we also have a hierarchy of time scales?
A hierarchy of what?
Time scales.
We are speaking about energy scales. And of course, a time scale can the time can go like an energy scale. Yeah, so I'm not speaking about time or whatever. I'm just saying that high energy in general corresponding to small distance and things like that. But
could I jump in just quickly?
Yes.
From a mathematical standpoint, when you're characterizing effective field theories, you sort of simultaneously have to identify the time scale with the length scales.
So I just
wondered whether there are any subtleties in identifying correct slow time scales as you do these effective field theories.
Yes, you are fully right. There are low time scales and fast time scales, also for the time. I mean, we will attach a scale also to the time. You will see when I will construct PNL effective field theories that the time associated to that will be ultra slow, for example. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks a lot for asking. Okay, so this matching coefficient, if the scale is large, can be calculated in perturbation theory. So this is very powerful because when you do that, the symmetry of that particular physical system that you are studying are becoming manifest. And you can use Ramanujan group equation to sum the large logs in the ratio of the scale. So let me explain to you how we can do this in our case. We have quarkonium in QCD. So I have quark anti-quark states, three times three bars that can be considered singlet and dotted. We start from QCD and we have all the scale, M and V and V square. And we can stick our ideas to the diagram that I've shown to you before. Then we want to integrate our scales that are not relevant for us. So we start from the scale of the mass. So if we look at this scale of the mass from farther away, we can map this to a four fermion term. And integrating out the scale M, we get the Lagrangian non-relativistic QCD, which is factorized between the product of matching coefficient that depend on alpha S as a scale M and contains the logarithm of M, so the non-analytic behavior in M, some degrees of freedom that are dynamic are represented in this operator and an expansion 1 over M. What I'm saying is that in non-relativistic QCD, you have still two scales, MV and V square, that get entangled. So we can go one step further and integrate out also the gluons that give the binding. Then if we do like that, then this diagram would be matched to this. We have quark anti-quark composed field that is traveling in a singlet, and then the first correction is a singlet that is emitting this low energy gluon, ultrasoft gluon, and the octet, and it's turning into an octet and then in a singlet. So the Lagrangian of PNR QCD appears in this factorized form. It has a piece that is coming from non-relativistic QCD. It is an expansion on R, it has new operators, and it has a new matching coefficient, and these matching coefficient are the modern interpretation of the potential. Then in QCD there is another scale relevant, so depending if MV is bigger than under QCD, then we have a system with more radius and we can go through weakly coupled PNR QCD. If MV is of order lambda QCD, we have a system with large radius, so the source scale is non-perturbative, and we have to go through strongly coupled PNR QCD and non-perturbative matching. In any case, a potential picture arises at the level of PNR QCD. It is perturbative in this case, non-perturbative in this case. So many people work at this passage, and we and our collaborator Kostraten worked out application of PNR QCD along this. So let me briefly tell you what is the Lagrangian non-relativistic QCD. Here we have Lagrangian non-relativistic QCD. This psi is a Pauli field of a fermion. This guy is a Pauli field of an antifermion. This operator here, you know that it comes, if you take the Dirac equation and you apply the fold in external field and you apply a folding Wootton transformation, you would get this. It's a kind of relativistic, non-relativistic expansion. But in non-relativistic QCD, you have this matching coefficient that are containing all the eigenenergy behavior. Moreover, you have these four fermion terms that you have to add. Moreover, these matching coefficients are series in alpha s, you can calculate the matching, and the coefficient of the four fermion term contains a real and imaginary part. And then you have the gluons, the light degrees of freedom that are the same. So it is an expansion, the Lagrangian expansion in V, and alpha is as a time m. The power candidate is still not, not unambiguous. The quarkonium field is written as an expansion in the Fock space, a quark anti-quark in a singlet, plus quark anti-quark in an octet and gluon, which is suppressed by order V with respect to Z, plus our stuff. And the four fermion terms are can contain singlet and octet, and they can be catalogated by the quantum number. Now, non-relativistic QCD is that a tremendous impact on many applications on spectrum lattice calculations were possible with non-relativistic QCD for the first time for every system, and has given a theoretical framework for quarkonium production like colliders and for decays. Now, what I'm advocating is that if you want to address a bound state dynamics, then you should go one step down and go to potential relativistic QCD. Potential relativistic QCD is the effective field theory for non-relativistic quark anti-quark pairs near threshold. With respect to the general definition of the Lagrangian or PNR effective field theory that I've written before, so the QFT is QCD. It is obtained by integrating out hard and soft gluons with a momentum and energy scale like M and MV. The degrees of freedom are quark-antiquark pairs that we often cast in core singlet and core octet, and ultra-soft modes, modes with very low energy, like quark, low-energy gluons. We can identify phi, for example, with a singlet here in this equation. The Lagrangian is organized in expansion in 1 over N and R, and this form of delta lambda and of the ultra-soft modes depends on the low energy dynamics. The power counting is apparent because the relative momentum is scaling like 1 over n, so it's scaling like mv. The binding energy is scaling like mv square. Also, the time is scaling like mv square. The momentum of the center of mass is scaling like mv square, and so on. And all the operator in delta L scale unambiguously like mv square to their dimension. So, an interesting aspect of this is that we factorize things, and at some point we have lambda QCD, so we have non-perturbative effects. Now, the form of this non-perturbative effects depends on the size of the physical system. If we are considering a quarkonium in which lambda QCD is a smaller scale of all, then the non-perturbative effects will be carried by local condensates. If lambda QCD is of order T, then we will have non-local condensate in time. So this F is a field strength. They can be electromagnetic or chromomagnetic field. If lambda QCD is of order MV, then the non-perturbative physics is carried in a standard object, Wilson loop. So the Nora, more... Yes.
There is another short question here. Masuk, yeah, go yeah. ahead.
Yeah, yeah.
Sorry, in the previous slide, you said that this is the theory near the threshold. I was missing what is the threshold exactly here.
Well, sorry, like TT bar states, they are close to bound state. You uh-huh. can think about bound state. If you have top antipod, top, they feel the potential, but they don't make a bound state. So they are called threshold states. So there are two exceptional thresholds. There is a threshold for heavy light decays, the strong decay threshold. That's one thing. And when we are speaking about bound state or threshold states, we are thinking about states that feel the influence of the potential. Okay?
Thanks.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for asking. So the more extended the physical object, the more we probe the non-perturbative vacuum. So it's extremely important to be able to calculate these condensates, these objects in on the lattice, and to calculate them in the effective field theory framework. That's why collaboration with our people, we found the Tunco CD lattice collaboration. Let me start introducing weakly cap PNR QCD. I have to go a little bit fast because I want to present some latest result to you. So weakly cap PNR QCD is a force system with a small radius. And we can do precision calculation of observable spectral decay transition and precise extraction of standard model parameters like alpha S, the mass of the channel, the bottom of the top. And of course, this result can be applied to any non-relativistic system of any nature. You can use force using particle, dark matter particle, or so on. So let me show what is the Lagrangian weakly cap PNR QCD. We have the gauge fields that are all multiple expanded to enforce that they are ultra soft. Then the first piece of the Lagrangian contains a singlet that you see here with a kinetic term and the single static potential and relativistic correction. Here, this is for the octet that is still this covariant derivative. And this is the leading order in the multiple expansion. You see, this would give two separate Schrödinger equation for the singlet and the octet. As the next two leading order in the multiple expansion, you see that the singlet and the octet are interacting, and the interaction is mediated by this ultra soft chromoelectric field. You have singlet octet interaction and octet octet interaction, and then you have the part of the Lagrangian for the light degrees of freedom that is not changed. The matching coefficient are the potential, and for this static potential, singlet and octet, the leading order is just the attractive Coulomb potential and the repulsive octet Coulomb potential. And this VA and VB are other potential that can be matched. From this Lagrangian, one can calculate the Feynman rules. This is the propagator of the singlet, this is the propagator of the octet, this is the vertex of interaction between octet and singlet with R dot A in the vertex, and this is the one for the octet octet. So what we can get from this Lagrangian? So PNRQCD provides a quantum mechanical description from field theory. The Schrödinger equation and the potential appear once all scales above the binding energy have been integrated out. This provides a clear definition of the potential. The effective field theory accounts also for non-potential terms. Typically, they provide loop correction to the potential picture. And this retardation effect are typically related to non-perturbative physics. Quantum mechanical divergence that you often have in this iteration of the potential in quantum mechanics are not there because they are cancelled by the NRQCD matching coefficient, because the effective field theory is equivalent to quantum field theory, which is well behaved in the ultraviolet. Poincaré invariance is intact and is realized via exact relation among the matching coefficient of potentials. So let me start from the QCD single static potential. There is a matching procedure, and this QCD single static potential is given by the static energy, the logarithm of the Wilson loop, minus this piece that is calculated in the effective field theory. So what we see from this is that the potential is a Wilson coefficient. It undergoes renormalization. It develops a scale dependencies depending on a scale mu and satisfies renormalization group equation, which allow to resum large logs. So the static energy is known as free loop, and the free loop it develops a term alpha to the 4 log alpha. And from the point of view of this definition, you understand it, this log alpha in the static energy, which is a physical quantity, signals the cancellation of contribution coming from soft and ultra soft gluons. In the effective field theory, there will be this cancellation between the mu dependence of the static potential and the mu dependence of this correlator. So everything works pretty well. And this, for example, explains the problem that was found in this Apekis-Dein-Mutzenich paper that we are trying to calculate the potential and encounter divergence. This is fully understood in the effective field theory. Now, this Quarkonian single static potential is one of the most important things in QCD. It has been calculated since the starting of QCD, and now we know it in nest to nest leading order, apart from the constant term for loop. And this is a treasure that has been developed by many people along the year. Billoir in the 80s started and go on up to 10 years ago to calculate this. The calculation in the effective field theory is simplified, and it has given this logarithm at the beginning, but it's not only that. Even if this is a very precise calculation and it is very good, so we know this object very precisely, for years it was not possible to make application of this because there were two big problems. There was a bad convergence of this series because there were large beta zero terms, and there were large logs, these large logs. In the effective field theory, you can solve both things. So you use a renormal subtracted scheme that allows you to eliminate this undetermination of the series. And then you use a renormalization group equation to sum the logs. Then this object is very well calculated. We have a lot of knowledge of this object, and we can use this knowledge to get more understanding of the strong interaction. And this is what we have done. So here, there are the data of the static energy, static potential, the lattice data in 2+1 compared to the perturbative calculation. So they are unquenched lattice data compared to the perturbative calculation. So we see that after that we have understood these things, the perturbative calculation is nicely converging, 3-level, one loop, nest-to-nest leading log, nest-to-nest-to-nest leading log to the lattice calculation. Moreover, this I have plotted as a curve, this perturbative calculation, but should be a band because there is some indetermination in alpha s. And the main error is carried by this lack of knowledge, of full knowledge of alpha s. Then we can use the comparison between perturbation theory and the lattice data to extract alpha s, and that's what we did. We extract alpha s at mz to this value in 2014, and recently we arrive at an even more precise extraction that is competitive and complementary to our extraction. Now, since we can calculate the potential with the matching procedure, we can calculate the relativistic correction to the potential, we can calculate loop correction to the potential, we can calculate everything that we need to go to physical application. Physical application to the spectrum. One nice thing is to look at the energy to order m alpha to the 5, next to next to next leading order, because at order m alpha to the 5, the Lamb shift, which is a purely quantum field theoretical effect, is giving a contribution. So the energy of quarkonium, for example, 1s bottomonium, is given by this formula. You have the mass, you have the average value of the kinetic energy and the potential, calculate at the precision that you need. And this is a kind of quantum mechanical calculation once you have the potential from the quantum field theory. And then you can add this thing. This thing is a calculation of this diagram, aspiration value is a calculation of this diagram in the effective field theory. And this diagram comes from the Feynman rules that I've given to you before. So it is this. And here in the vertices, there is this electric field that gives you this QCD correlator. This QCD correlator is controlled by the scale under QCD. So we can have two limits. When mv squared is bigger than lambda QCD, we have local condensate. When mv squared is for the lambda QCD, we have really the Lamb shift. The Lamb shift is analogous to the Lamb shift in QED. We have this low energy gluon in this case that is leaving while the system is bound. These are the gluons that gives you the binding. So the two things are entangled. And then with this formula, we can use this formula to gain knowledge. We have a very precise determination of the quarkonium energy, and we know this formula in perturbation theory. The effect of this correlator that is non-perturbable is suppressed. So we can extract a precise determination of the bottom mass and the char mass. Now, let me come to strongly coupled PNR QCD. So this is MV of order lambda QCD, and this is relevant for quarkonia or state with two or more quark with a larger radius. And we want to stay below the strong decay threshold. So what is important here is that we really achieve a factorization of high energy and low energy contribution. And the low energy contribution will depend only on the glue. So they can be calculated on the lattice, and we will have a power in prediction, and we'll be able to study confinement effects. Moreover, we can exploit the knowledge of the bound state dynamics to reduce the non-perturbative unknowns, and I will show this to an application to quarkonium production. And again, this can be applied to our system besides QCD. So we are hitting the non-perturbative case. R is of order lambda minus one QCD. So the degrees of freedom can be only singlet, nothing colored can travel. So we can have quark antiquark in a singlet, quark antiquark plus global, or quark antiquark in a octet with a gluon. And this is an hybrid. And the gluon is a scale under QCD, so this is a non-perturbative problem. So we should get some inspiration from a non-perturbative calculation. What we can do is write out formally, we know what is the leading Hamiltonian, the zero-order Hamiltonian in relativistic QCD that is containing essentially the chromoelectric field, chromoelectric chromagnetic fields. And the eigenstate of this can be written formally in this way. These are the static energies that depend on x1 and x2. We have a quark put in x1 and antiquark put in x2. Then this state and bar x1, x2 is obtained by the action of the creator of the quark and the antiquark over these states that contain any type of low energy gluons. And this thing here is a non-perturbative thing. So we cannot calculate it, but we can use symmetry to catalogate it. And then we can catalogate it with quantum number using the symmetry group, the infinity age, which is the same symmetry group that is used in the diatomic molecule. So here we have a quark, here we have antiquark, here we may imagine to have glue around a non-perturbative glue. And then we can use a quantum number like lambda. So we have the momentum of the glue, we project around this axis, and this gives us this quantum number, rotational quantum number, lambda, that can be sigma pi d. Then we use Cp, and then for the sigma states, we use the eigenvalue reflection with respect to this plan. So we have quantum number, we can distinguish static energy non-perturbatively. we do, what people have done, is to calculate the static energy on the lattice. So this is a quark antiquark distance. This thing here is a quark antiquark static singlet energy, static singlet potential. And there you have the hybrid excitation. This n0 with n different from zero. So you see that there are a bunch of them, and we will come back to that when we are studying the xyz. Now we are only interested in quarkonions. The only information that we care is that the gap between the static singlet thing and the hybrid stuff is lambda cosine. Now, the Fatty Field theory is giving you a prescription. PNR cosine and the potential come from integrating out all the scales bigger than the energy, bigger than mv square. This means that this gluonic excitation should be integrated out. This means that the strongly coupled PNR cosine will be written just for the singlet quarkonium field. And this delta lambda will contain US degrees of freedom that can be only pions. If we ignore this, we will have just a kind of potential model. So you see that the Fatty Field theory is predicting a poor potential description, but this potential that contain a real and imaginary part, they are calculated from QCD, they are the potential of QCD, and the real part is given the spectra, and the imaginary part is given the decays. So they are given in the non-perturbative matching in term of generalized Wilson loop. The nice thing is that we have pulled off all the flavor dependence. So we can calculate all this potential, at least formally, in terms of this Wilson generalized Wilson loop. We have a static singlet potential, 1/n correction, spin-dependent correction at order 1m², and velocity-dependent correction. The static potential is given by the log of the Wilson loop, which is nothing else that the quark antiquark created at some time, and then they are infinitely massive, they don't propagate, they change only the time, and then they are annihilated here. So this object here is described by the exponential of the gluon field around this circuit. This is a Wilson loop, static Wilson loop, can be calculated on the lattice and give you the potential. And then, same thing you can do for the spin-dependent potential. In the Fatty Field theory, it comes out in this form. You see, this is the spin orbit term, this is the tensor term, and this is the spin-spin term that we know from our system. This matching coefficient, CF, are coming from non-relativistic QCD and contains the logarithm of the mass. This object here are generalized static Wilson loop with insertion of electric and magnetic fields. They depend only on the glue. They can be called the gauge invariants. They can be calculated on the lattice. And this entails doing only one lattice calculation, getting the potential, inserting them in the Schrödinger equation, and getting the whole spectrum of charmonium, bottomonium, BC. Not to do a calculation of the green function for each state, as it is in general done on the lattice. You see that the spin orbit term is emerging at order 1m², and this will be a difference with respect to the exotics as when I will arrive to that. So when you have this, you can calculate this thing on the lattice, you get for this potential very precise determination, and then you can compare them with your preferred QCD vacuum model, and you get information on the confinement and the QCD mechanism. So the nice thing is that you reduce everything, you factorize, you reduce the information on confinement in gauge invariant, low energy object, depending only on the glue, and then you can compare to models, and so you can learn more. And as I told you, there is Poincaré invariance that gives you a Zater relation between the potential. I will not enter in this. Now, let me present an application, interesting application of that. Application to quarkonium production. So it's extremely interesting to study quarkonium production at collider, and especially quarkonium production as a large hadron collider. There are lots of people in the theory that are trying to develop the theory for that, which is mainly based on relativistic QCD. So non-relativistic QCD has given a factorization formula for the cross-section of quarkonium. H is a quarkonium, sigma is a cross-section, and it comes out in a factorized form, in this form. So this Fn is containing short distance coefficient and hard stuff, partonic, hard scattering cross-section, convoluted with parton distribution. This thing here is a low energy one, and these are long distance matrix element, L, D, and E. They give the probability of a Q-Q-bar pair with certain quantum number to evolve into a final quarkonium. if you look into this, you see that they are vacuum expectation value of four fermion operators that are in non-relativistic QCD with core singlet or core rotor contribution. And in the middle, they have a projection over quark onion plus anything else, light. So they written in this form, they cannot be calculated on the lattice. The point is that if you want to become, to become precise and to calculate this object, this cross section, you add the term in the expansion in 1 over m, in you add many of these LDME. So these are non-perturbative objects. They are universal, but they should get should be extracted from the data, and they depend on the considered quarkonium state. So when you go on with the calculation in the expansion in V, you get many of them. So we can use our knowledge of the bouncing dynamics to reduce this non-perturbative object. We can use the factorization of this LDME in PNR QCD. We can factorize them in terms of wave function and universal non-perturbative correlators that depend only on the glue. What we achieve is the following. The number of non-perturbative unknowns is reduced by alpha, and the non-perturbative unknowns are correlator of gluonic fields that can be calculated on the lattice. So let me give you a concrete example. This is inclusive hadron production of p-wave quarkonia. At leading order can be written in this form. This is the cross section, these are short distance things, and these are the low energy things, this LDME. In PNR QCD, I can write the singlet one just in terms of the wave function, product of the wave function. And this, which is the octet one, is a product of the square of the wave function and this universal electric correlator that is given here. It is a correlator of electric field with Wilson line. Now, the interesting thing is that this object does not depend on quark flavor or radial excitation. So if we fix them once from the data, then we can make a lot of prediction on charmonion sector, bottomonion sector, and with different states. And this is what we have done. So we fixed the psi on the ratio of KC2 and KC1, large hadron collider, and we could predict all this, the cross-section of the same states, the cross-section in the bottomonion sector, this feed-down fraction, and the polarization. So you see how this is helping in understanding the non-perturbative physics and reducing the determination. Now, let me come to this other point. So this effective field theory is allowing you to address the bouncing dynamics, but is also useful in the case in which you have additional scale. We can imagine that we have quarkonium inside a hot QCD medium characterized by a temperature. Then we can use the same framework and we can integrate out scale and use also the thermal loop effective field theory to address the thermal scale. In this way, we can obtain the thermal effect in the potential. For example, in a situation like that, if T is bigger than MV, then T will give a contribution to the potential. And we will be able to use this description to calculate thermal effect. This is what we have done. And what you discover is that you can use PNR QCD at finite temperature to get the potential, which is a function of the distance and the temperature. And it is dictating through the Schrödinger equation, the real time evolution of the quark-antiquark pair. This potential has a real part and an imaginary part. And this imaginary part comes from two physical origins. One is Landau damping that you have also in QED, and it is related to the physical process of inelastic parton scattering. And the other, it is a thing that is only in QCD, which is a singlet to octet transition that is related to glue dissociation. So we calculate in all the hierarchy the thermal effect to the potential and to the energy. And what we found, the effective field theory produced that the temperature effect can be different from screening. And what do you, when you do this calculation, you have the tool to do this calculation, you understand that the dissociation of quarkonium is driven by the imaginary part of the potential instead than by the device screening as it was hypothesized by Matsui Sasa. Moreover, the effective theory gives you a technology to calculate systematically thermal energy and width. So you can recalculate, for example, the spectrum of quarkonium final T at order M alpha to the phi. Now, let me skip this and let me come to the frontier of the non-relativistic bound state. So, two are the big frontier. One is are these non-relativistic pairs with light degrees of freedom that give contribution to the binding. This is creating a set of exotic states S, Y, Z with different properties from what we are used to that have been observed at colliders. And here, what I will present to you is the Born-Oppenheimer effective theory. Then the other very interesting problem is the evolution of non-relativistic pairs in a non-equilibrium in the medium that can be the quark-gluon plasma or the early universe. And what we do to address this physical issue is use PNR QCD plus open quantum system. And we will arrive at Lindblad equation for the evolution of the density matrix. Let me start from the second problem. So the non-equilibrium evolution of quarkonia in a strongly coupled quark-gluon plasma. We work in this hierarchy. We are considering quarkonia with a small radius. They are really useful probe of a strongly coupled plasma. So we are using, for example, Y1S bottomonium. So 1 over R is bigger than T. Then we assume that T can be of the same order of GT, so the plasma can be fully strongly coupled. And then this is bigger than the other scale, that is the energy, and so on. We describe the evolution of singlet and dotted quarkonium with a matrix density evolution using open quantum system and for the calculation of the vertex, PNR QCD finite. So the idea is to use the as a subsystem, the quarkonium, characterized by the energy scale E, the binding energy, and as environment, the quark-gluon plasma, characterized by T, or if it is in equilibrium, if it is not in equilibrium, any other parameter that describes it. And then we can define a density matrix in potential relativistic QCD for the heavy quark-antiquark pair in a singlet and dotted configuration that are this fake. The system is in non-equilibrium because through interactions of the subsystem, the quarkonium is in non-equilibrium because through interaction with the environment, which is a QGP, singlet and dotted quark-antiquark system continuously transform in each other. Also, the number of heavy quarks remain conserved. And moreover, this description is fully quantum and non-abelian. It is the first time that this can be achieved. So, these are the master equations that we can obtain for the evolution of the matrix density of the singlet and the dotted. It's evolution with the time, that is evolution with the temperature or any other parameters that characterize the quark-gluon plasma out of equilibrium. And this evolution is characterized by the Hamiltonian, the singlet, the dotted, and then by some self-energy. So we have the self-energy of the sigma type for the singlet and the dotted, and they provide the medium shift of the mass and the width. Through this equation, you see that this sigma controls the shift, the thermal shift, or the medium shift of the mass of the singlet and the dotted, and the width in the medium of the singlet and the dotted. And then we have these other sides that are in this equation, and they are self-energy that accounts for the production of singlet through the decay of octet. And this is, these other two are accounting for the production of octets through the decay of singlet and octet, respectively. And they come from the chromoelectric dipole vertex that I show you in the PNR QCD Lagrangian. Then, this equation can be very far out of equilibrium, and they are non Markovian in general. Then, if we make also this expansion, we assume that we take into account that the energy of the quarkonia is smaller than the temperature, then we can reduce from those master equations to a Lindblad equation for a strongly coupled plasma, for the evolution of quark on a strongly coupled plasma that reads like this. So this is the change in time of the matrix density. This is the Hamiltonian. And this object here are the so-called collapse operators that I've written here. So the most interesting thing is that both the Hamiltonian and the collapse operator are controlled by two objects that are gamma and kappa. These are objects that are defined in field theory. So they are given here. They are correlator of electric fields. Kappa is the heavy quark momentum diffusion coefficient that we know. And this is its imaginary counterpart. They are non-perturbative, so they should be calculated on the lattice. And they characterize the QGP. So we can characterize the QGP in terms of this, and we can use the quarkonium as a probe of it. And the nice thing is that the Fatty Field Theory allows us to use lattice QCD equilibrium calculation to study, so a fixed T, to study while we are evolving in T or in time, to study the non-equilibrium evolution. So a Fatty Field Theory is here and intermediately. And what we got in collaboration with this author here is this result again. We have this nuclear modification factor that I quoted at the beginning is given by the projection of the matrix density of the singlet after the final evolution. And this calculation has no free parameter, and the result depends only on this kappa that has been measured on the lattice in a large interval of t. So we make this kappa changing with time, and gamma that we keep constant, it has been also extracted from the lattice. And these are results compared to ELIS, ATLAS, and CMS. These data here are the 1S data, and these are the 2S and the 3S. And in this left plot, we are varying kappa inside the band in which it has been calculated on the lattice. And this band is responsible from this variation while gamma is fixed. And in this our panel, we do the reverse. Kappa is fixed in the center of the band and we vary gamma. So we see that we can use RAA to learn about the QGP. And these similar things can be applied to dark matter. The dark matter evolution in the early universe is typically characterized by Boltzmann equation. The main ingredient of the Boltzmann equation is an annihilation cross section that should be calculated accurately, taking into account a bound state effect because it has to comply with the density of the dark matter that has been measured. And this is related to the mass of the particles that you are considering. So you should be very precise in this calculation. Moreover, you should write down a Lindblad equation that is a quantum field theory version of this object. So the problem is very similar. We are applying this method to these studies. Now, let me ask, how many minutes do I have?
It's not very strict. You could take maybe 5 more minutes.
Okay, 5 more minutes. I can go faster through the X, Y, Z, and then we arrive at the question. Thanks. Okay, so let me very briefly tell you the main things about the Born-Oppenheimer effective field theory. So what is the Born-Oppenheimer approximation? It is something that we all are familiar with. That if you are dealing with molecular physics, then in QED, then you are describing typically these nuclei, these two nuclei that are the slow degrees of freedom and there are the electron that are the fast degrees of freedom. So we have a separation of scales. This situation is very similar to the situation of quarkonium hybrids or tetraquarks, in which you have the fat thing, the two heavy quarks that are the slow degrees of freedom, and then you have the gluon or the light quarks that are the fast degrees of freedom. And what is going on in this picture? It's going on that the electron in QED or the gluon fields in QCD change adiabatically in presence of the heavy quark or the nuclei. And the heavy quarks or nuclear interaction may be described a leading order in the non-relativity expansion by an effective potential V of kappa between the static source. This kappa labels the difference excitation of the light degrees of freedom. And these are the quantum numbers that I explained to you before. Then, once you get this V of kappa, you can construct a plethora of states on each potential by solving the corresponding Schrödinger equation. This is the situation when you are in QED, you see, you get the VO kappa, you solve the Schrödinger equation, you get the levels, and then you have the next kappa, which is kappa prime, and so on. And in QCD is the same. These are the hyperstatic energy, for example, that I presented to you. And you get them, you may solve the Schrödinger equation and get all these levels. So this picture goes under the name of Bortle-Mappelheimer approximation. What we can do, what we've done, is starting from PNR-QED and PNR-QCD, we have made rigorous this approximation, constructing a suitable normalistic effective field theory called PO effective field theory. So the main idea is this one. We have separation of scale. So lambda QCD, which is the scale of the light stuff, this glue, for example, or glue and light quartz, is much bigger than B square, like in QED, this situation. So we proceed to integrate out 1 over n and then lambda QCD. Of course, lambda QCD is non-perturbative. So in order to integrate it out, we need guidance from the lattice that is able to do a non-perturbative calculation. So typically, we will focus on these static energy, sigma u minus and pu, that are degenerated very small r, and can give this static potential. And we construct the BO effective field theory for this state for the static energy pu and sigma u minus that have the quantum number 1 plus minus. And this is the effective field we construct. You see, this is a hybrid field. This is the time derivative. This is the static potential. And here you have a kinetic term, but not only that. And the point is that you have this term, so you can rewrite this thing here with this kinetic term, as usually in the Schrödinger equation, and this thing. This thing is a non-adiabatic coupling that is known also from molecular physics and is giving a mixing between the states. So we constructed this effective field theory and we got coupled, these are Schrödinger equation, with this static potential is taken from the lattice, and these are coupled Schrödinger equation. And this effect here is giving a mixing and will give effects on the spectrum. So the Schrödinger equation mixes states with the same parity, but that non-adiabatic coupling is giving a lambda doubling. So it is lifting the degeneracy between states with opposite parity. This is also happening in molecular physics, but in QCD is enhanced. Then we can construct all the multiplets of the hybrids using, at the moment, we are not considering the spin of the quark, and we consider this multiplet with this quantum number, depending on the static energy that we are used. And then this multiplet, this band here are our predictions that are compared to neutral isotic Chermonian states that have been observed, this X, Y, Z that has been observed in this experiment. And these bands here come from the uncertainty in the lattice determination of the glulam mass, which is a non-perturbative parameter entering this calculation. And if that would be reduced, we could reduce also the indetermination of the calculations. And I want only to say another thing that is extremely interesting. So using the effective field theory, we can go through the matching procedure and we can also calculate relativistic correction. In particular, for the phenomenology of these states, it's important to calculate the spin-dependent potential. Now, when you go through this calculation, and this is not known in any model, you get a spin contribution also at order 1 over n. You have seen that in the case of quarkonium, the spin-dependent contribution is starting at order 1 square. Here, since you have the spin of the gluon that is not suppressed in the mass, you will get a spin term, this spin term here, at order 1 over n. And this will tell you that in the phenomenology, the spin splittings will be less suppressed than in heavy quarkonium in the case of azote. And this is extremely important for phenomenological application. So we calculate in the matching this spin structure, and this is gauged by, is multiplied by this object, this potential depends on R, and they contain non-perturbative part. There are 6 of them, and the only flavor dependent, they are only depending on the glue, and the only flavor dependence is carried by the non-relativistic QCD matching coefficient. So what we did, we could fix these 6 non-perturbative correlator on some lattice data on Chermonium hybrids. So we did that, and from the lattice, we got this contribution. This was a part of the perturbative calculation that has the opposite sign of the non-perturbative one. This is interesting because in models, they always copy the calculations that come from the perturbative part. And then the final result is this one in the case of Charmonium. Now, you see the power of the Fettig field theory. Once we can fix this non-perturbative low energy correlators that don't depend on the flavor, we can make prediction for Bottomonio. Bottomonio is much more difficult at the moment still for hybrids to be calculated on the lattice. So from here, we fixed our non-perturbative correlator, and then here we could get this prediction on the multiplet. Here I just presented the H1 multiplet, we have many of them. And we see this blue are our prediction, and this in violet are the current lattice calculation from this paper. Okay, let me come to the conclusion. So potential artistic effective field theory give us a powerful tool to address non-relativistic bound and threshold states in quantum field theory. In QCD, potential artistic QCD makes Quarconium a precious probe of strong interaction. PNR QCD allows to perform systematic high-order calculation on bound state, to factorize and study non-perturbative effects, and the relation between perturbative and non-perturbative effects, for example, between renormalons and condensates. And the factorization allows model-independent prediction and direct lattice calculation of low-energy quantities. Then the Fettig field theory allows to define objects of great phenological interest, that is, the potential at zero and finite temperature. There was no way to define the potential at finite temperature in all the hierarchy before that, the introduction of the Fettig field theory, and gives also a scheme for the calculation of energy in the case. If we combine the Fettig field theory with open quantum systems, then we can gain a framework to study the non-equilibrium evolution on the relativistic states. And this, as we have seen, allows a diagnostic of the quark gluon plasma in terms of two non-perturbative transport coefficients with a clear QFT definition. And it allows to use lattice equilibrium calculation for non-equilibrium studies. We have seen that with Born-Oppenheim effective field theory, we get also a novel framework to explore complex non-relativistic strong interactive systems like the SYZ states. And what I think that is very important, the alliance of PNR QCD with lattice and with our effective field theory display plays a key role. And in general, PNR effective field theory is a flexible and very versatile tool that could be applied to the real of atomic condensed matter beyond the standard model, any physics, whenever the non-relativistic state play a role. Okay, thanks a lot for your passion. Now, please ask me questions.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for your presentation. And now let's go to questions. I see one raised hand. Masood Shokri, please, you may start.
Okay, I wanted to ask about this part that was related to the quark plasma.
Yeah.
And you are saying that the quarkonium is out of equilibrium. But are you assuming that the environment is in equilibrium?
No, in fact, I mean, what we have done in general, you see, let me go down here. So this equation here are very far from equilibrium. They are in normal Markovian. And here the time is evolving, can be related to the temperature or can be related to any parameter that is characterizing the non-equilibrium evolution of the medium. So I mean, what is interesting actually is that in this calculation in PNR QCD, we have just to assume that there is a medium that is giving you a scale, okay? Mm-hmm. If this scale is a temperature, you define the temperature only in equilibrium, as you are saying, of course, no? Or it is something else, that is anyway, it's the same for this calculation. Then for the application that we have done, we are evolving, the temperature is changing, and we are assuming that at any time you can define something that is a temperature. But I mean, it's not so relevant, is the parameter that is defining your medium. Then if you use The lattice calculation, yes, this is the lattice calculation at a given temperature, and you are changing the value of kappa while you change the temperature. Going through the fireball, the temperature is coming down from 500 up to 215 MeV. That's what we are going to. But in principle, the same calculation would be completely out of far from equilibrium. And then there would be, then you cannot use lattice, of course, but you should use something like kinetic equation or that can give you, you can, this correlator, this kappa has been calculated in kinetic theory with, you can use a classical lattice calculation and calculate it. So also that could be done. I mean, in here we have used the calculation of kappa on lattice at in equilibrium and you change the temperature is changed over a very large interval up to 10 to the 14 T from 1.1 TC up to 10 to the 4 TC. So it was really a large change. But this calculation can be used also much farther away from equilibrium. Yes, yes. Then of course you cannot use lattice. Yes, yes.
Thank you very much.
Classic lattice or kinetic theory. Yes, right. Thanks for the question.
Okay, next question, Kirill Boguslavsky. Go ahead.
Hi, thank you very, very much.
I was quoting your calculation, actually.
Yes, I heard that. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the very nice talk. I have, my question is about, the kappa force or gamma are defined as the correlation functions of E fields, for instance, or correlation functions of fields, while the potential is usually written down or computed as expectation values of Wilson loops, for instance. And it is usually people say that the potential coming from those Wilson loops is nothing else than the low distance behavior of the kappa. Have there been calculations that have shown that on the lattice, for instance, that you really get the same number kappa from the low distance behavior of the Wilson loop potential?
Okay, well, things are a little bit more complicated. As I was saying, you can get different non-perturbative objects depending on the degree of non-perturbativeness. So when lambda is of order MV, you get this Wilson loop, okay? But then you can have several scales. And you may, for example, you integrate out MV and you assume that MV is bigger than lambda QCD, for example, or bigger than T, and then you get a Coulomb potential. But then T or lambda QCD are bigger than the energy. Then, in order to get contribution to the potential, the Fedefit theory is telling you integrate out everything up to the energy because the potential is what is not depending on the energy. So you have also to integrate out these scales. Then if you go like that, you will find that you get this non-local condensate in time in the definition of the potential. So we have made calculation in which, for example, lambda QCD is intermediate between MV and V square. And then we get an additional contribution, you get Coulomb potential plus a part that is correlated, that is proportional to the electric correlator. Okay. And the same thing you can think in when you have the scale T, that you can get a contribution to the potential. Yes. I mean, it's not an alternative to the Wilson loop. If I don't know there can be a contribution of the type that is a contribution to the potential, then one has to look at the problem, identify the scales, and do the calculation. Several calculations of that type has already been done, in which there is electric correlators that is contributing to the potential. Yes. So it is not. Yes, can happen.
So is it part of the potential or is it really something which is on top of the Wilson loop, as of the potential that you extract from the Wilson loop?
If the Wilson loop is there when you have lambda QCD of order MV, and then you don't add anything else to the potential unless I mean, the Wilson loop, when you expand it, you get also contribution to the Wilson loop. But why you should, it depends on the system. I mean, it depends on the system and the skills. So what I can tell you is that there are contribution of those things that I in my mind, I have Coulomb potential plus a contribution of that type. In any case, the Wilson loop in short distance is reducing to Coulomb potential plus correction.
Okay,
so,
okay.
It's there is no contradiction between these two things, but one is to look at the situation and look at the scales and then can understand what it is.
Okay, thank you very much.
But the Wilson loop in itself, you have to keep it unexpanded, or you can expand it and then you get the Coulomb potential plus all the other correction. Huh? And then if there is an intermediate scale, you will get the electric correlated to the potential. But one has to look at the hierarchy of scales and do the calculation. But yes, there is no contradiction between the two things, but one has to look with details. Okay.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Thanks for the question. That's interesting. Thank you.
Okay. I don't see any questions immediately from the audience. So I had one question of my own that I wanted to clarify. When you were discussing the dissociation of quark cornea in coagulant plasma, you essentially came to the conclusion that it is not the debye screening that makes the main effect on dissociation. So can you maybe elaborate a little bit physics-wise, which are the physics processes that are dominating them?
No, you are fully right, because it was too fast and I don't have any details on that. In general, I have some slides to justify that. The point is that when you use FTF theory, you assume a hierarchy and then you start integrating out scales, okay? And we did that in all the hierarchy in PNR, QCD, FINAT. And then you see that when you start integrating out, so you reach the screening regime in which you have this exponential of minus M, MDR, you reach it when R is of order 1 over MD. So you reach it at the temperature, at a larger temperature. So if you start integrating out things and calculate the potential, you will get the imaginary part of the potential, and you will get the imaginary part of the potential at a smaller temperature. So the imaginary part of the potential is so large that the system is already gone before you reach the hierarchy of scales that is giving you a screening behavior. That's why. So I have typically a slide in which I compare the parametric behavior of the screening and the one with the imaginary part. And we see that the one with the imaginary part is dominating before arriving at temperature sufficiently large to give the screening, because you get a different contribution in the potential depending on the hierarchy of scales. So you are in the screening regime only when R is of order 1 over MD. And this means something, all these calculations are done with differently from the non-equilibrium evolution. These calculations are done for G perturbative, okay?
But can you elaborate perhaps on what's the physics mechanisms that leads to this imaginary part that dominates the dissociation?
Okay, that's yes. This I even have the slides. Thanks, sorry. So where was it? Finally, yeah. So the physical origin is the Landau damping, and which is related to inelastic Parton scattering. Essentially, you have to cut a diagram like that. You have the scattering of the gluon that is giving the binding with the light quarks in your quark gluon plasma. And this is giving this imaginary part. So if you cut a diagram like that, you will create an imaginary part. And the other situation, this is one effect, and this effect is dominating when the MD is bigger than the binding energy. Instead, this other effect that is typical of QCD singlet to hot transition is related to gluon dissociation. And this is an effect that is dominating when the binding energy is bigger than the debye mass. So they are characterized by different, also one is time-like effect and the other is space-like, I think. You can, at leading order, you can separate the two effects pretty nicely. So you see what it is, this inelastic pattern scattering, what is this glow dissociation. When you go on with the perturbative calculation, all these are perturbative calculation in G, they get entangled. But this is the physics that is underlying this imaginary part. So it's the scattering with the particle or gluons or light quarks and gluons in different kinematic regime. These are the underlying origin of the imaginary part, yes. And okay. When the imaginary part is as big as the real part, then the system is going to dissociate. And this is happening as the temperature is smaller than the temperature that is needed to create the screening. That's okay. What you see in this PNR considered finite description when, in this case, we use perturbation theory in G. Okay, this is a caveat. While in the non-perturbative, in the non-equilibrium evolution, we don't need to assume anything about the QGP. So T is equal to GT. G can be one.
Okay, this is much more clear. But then there is a follow-up question, which I kind of help asking. If that's the case, is that motivational slide where you were saying that this square cornea could be used as the temperature gauges, is that still valid with this new insight?
Well, it's that I was also thinking that this is the motivation of Marsouet-Sats. I mean, it is related to that. It is a static picture, no?
While so it's not valid anymore then?
Well, I think that is not so useful.
Can I make a comment?
Yeah, sure. Sure. Ahead,
I would say that it's still valid, right? I mean, so. It's a different thing. You don't have these sort of thresholds that Matsuyo and Sats were thinking of back in the day, that state would just disappear at these magical thresholds in temperature. It's more smeared out, but of course the total effect in what you get on RA depends on the time history of the evolution. And that goes into these decay rates, what the local temperature is. And that gets reflected in RA. So yeah, it does depend on the temperature. So if I assume a different initial temperature and I run it through the system now with the imaginary parts, the final RA change. So there's still a correlation. It's not uncorrelated.
Well, is there a justification for that statement, Mike, though? I mean, is there some calculations that supports what you said?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, many of them, I think.
Well,
just
I mean—
kinetics, right? Isn't that fair to say? It's just kind of, the kinetics, it is temperature T, you'll have faster rates all the time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, one could say, on the other hand, that if this is coming from a typical QCD plasma interaction and this imaginary parts will grow more or less in the same way relative to their masses for all the quark cornea or most of the quark cornea, irrespective of their differences, then basically it will not be a gauge.
No. So this was tested in the past, I guess about 10 years ago. And what you find is that I think it's also in Nora's paper. So for the excited state, the decay rates are still higher. So you still have this hierarchical suppression of the states with their ordered by their binding energy, essentially.
Well, we see that the fact that the excited states are gone before, we see that. Yeah, I mean, it's still there, but it's not so, I mean, it's indirectly there. There is a relation to radius, to temperature, and so on, but it's not so eating the imaginary like before. That is more a static picture. We see that it's very important to have the non-equilibrium picture and so on. Of course, everything is related to the type of quark cornea, is related to the temperature, how much is suppressed or not, of course, yes.
Okay, I see this is something that you all have to sort out even better so that people who are like me observing the field from outside a little bit would get a little bit more clear sort of message so that perhaps it can be used in some other applications. But anyway, thank you. I appreciate the answers. Any other questions before we wrap this up? I don't see any raised hands. So before concluding, I would like to use the opportunity to thank Nora for a nice presentation, and thank you everybody for